Welcome to episode 15 of FilmTracks. I am flying solo today. Jesse is not here with us, but she will be back next week. Today we have a very special guest with us. Daniel Alcheh is here. He's a versatile composer and a prolific songwriter. His previous works have been labeled as the discovery of 2011 and most notably one of the top 10 film scores of 2011 as well. He's here to talk to us about his most recent work, The Trouble with Bliss. Do not go anywhere. It's awesome.
Hosting and bandwidth for Trigla is provided by Media Temple.
Welcome, episode 15. I can't believe it's been 15 weeks, but here we are with a very special guest, Mr. Alcheh.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much for coming.
Mr.
Mr. Alcheh. I just love your last name. It sounds so cool to say. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having
me. It's an honor to have you. And,
Thank you.
Know, I have to say, like, listening to you, I had never heard your music in full before. And after listening to your score, I was like, who is this guy? Like, why haven't I heard of him yet? You know, where has he been? And listened to all your music, or most of it anyway, that I could find. And so, yeah, tell us a little bit about where you came from and, like, your background in film scoring. I remember you said that you had started at a very early age.
Well, I started writing. I wasn't doing film, of course. But, yeah, I was, I think, in my teens, I was really interested, immediately, I was not interested in performing or something like that. I was really interested in writing, and I remember that, yeah, it's a vivid memory, how I was always drawn to that.
I mean, how did you grow up in a musical family?
I did grow up in a very musical, classical musical kind of family. My dad was very into classical music. He was a flautist and violinist himself, but he wasn't doing it as a, you know, he did it when he was younger. He played, he studied, but he was never a he was never a professional when he was grown up.
What made you want to go into writing specifically for film or for images that you see on screen? Was there a specific moment that inspired you to
do guess,
that?
You know, you get pulled into it because you really love films and you're really, you know, the medium is really interesting. And once you do it,
you're kind of hooked
because it's very alluring. It's very, the process is very interesting. You know, you writing something for a different medium where, you know, music is not, it's not just the music itself. You're writing to serve a different medium,
a purpose.
Right. Yeah. And it just creates, just on the writing side, purely writing, it creates, you know, there's a very interesting dynamic to it.
Well, one of the things that, struck me about your music was that it sounded very, I don't know how to say it, like classical based. Like there's a classical element to it.
Right.
It's not like a Hans Zimmer sound.
Right.
Which is very synth.
We do that too.
It seems very organic.
Yeah. Right.
Period instruments. It seems like with some of your right. score, especially The Trouble with Bliss, seems like you use a lot of, of specific instruments for it.
Right.
But talk a little bit about The Man Who Collected Food. Was this your first film score, or had you done many prior
to it? No, I did other things before. This was just, I moved from New York 4 years ago.
Okay.
And it was a very strange story. I arrived in LA, and I had some projects going. At some point, I realized I have to move because the work was here.
Right. As everybody seems to.
At some point, you're like, yeah. I was working with some colleagues and doing some projects. We did some TV stuff and some other films. Mm-hmm. And a colleague wrote me and said, you know, I just saw a director post somewhere that he is looking for someone who, he needs someone that can write Baroque style music for his feature. And I just finished some music for Warner Brothers for their library with a few colleagues, and that's what I wrote. And it was just the fact, it was just so the pure coincidence. It was so strange that I said, I don't even remember where that posting came from, but the guy sent it to me and said, "Isn't it weird that you just finished this thing and you did this Vivaldi style stuff?" And he said, "You have to write him just because of the coincidence."
You know, it's funny that you say Vivaldi because that's exactly what I was going to say. I was like, the first cue sounds exact. I mean, it doesn't sound exactly, right, but right. It sounds like inspired by.
Right, right. And that's what he was looking for some of the cues. The scores, I don't know if you heard the whole thing, but some of the cues are like that.
Very specific ones.
Right.
So talk a little bit about what is this film, The Man Who Collected Food?
Is it a wacky...
It's a documentary or is it kind of a comedy?
It's a comedy. It's a horror comedy.
Okay.
It's a very, very offbeat kind of, wild concept. The director was very, very young.
Okay.
And I saw some of the footage when he brought it. Anyway, I wrote him and I said, he wrote back and said, "Yeah, let's meet."
And
when he showed me some of the stuff, some of the rough cuts he had, some of the stuff was just so beautiful, crazy, but so beautiful, just really beautiful shots, like Kubrick style shots.
That you were just like, I have to
write some stuff. Yeah, I have to take this project.
Well, I think what we should do for the audience, in case they don't know your music, and I actually, when I looked you up on Spotify, I don't know who to talk to, the audience or you, but you're on Spotify, which is great, and
you've got
The Man Who Collected Food, with the whole soundtrack there,
right.
And you also have Leave You and Me, which is original soundtrack Sweets.
It was a short 20-minute film.
Which is very cool, from 2007.
Yeah, yeah.
And anyway.
Bliss is there?
Huh?
Is Trouble With Bliss there?
Trouble With Bliss is also
on Spotify. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Which was great because I, had got the CD and I was listening to that.
Yep.
And then I was like, "Oh, it'd be so great if I could tell the audience to find you on Spotify,"
sure.
Which I always do.
Sure.
So that Trouble With Bliss is also on there, which we'll talk about in a sec. But let me show the audience really quick this first track, which is called The Dagger. It's the theme from The Man Who Collected Food, and it's incredibly surprising and awesome. We'll listen to about 45 seconds or so. So here, check it out. Mm-hmm. I was like, when I heard that, I was like, "What? Why haven't I heard this cue before?" I mean, it's a huge cue. I mean, it's very bold.
Yeah, it's a lot of work.
And you've got
players,
amazing players
really hard,
in it. So, how? I mean, you said that this director was very young.
Yeah, very young.
But it seems like a very mature score. I mean, for
he really
horror comedy.
Oh yeah, yeah, you know what I mean? He really knew what he wanted, and I was so impressed. And I, you know, we sat a lot and talked a lot. It was really fun to work with him. He really cared deeply about the music and what he wanted. And
that's great.
You know,
it's good to hear that, because I feel like, you know, one of the things that you always learn in school, especially if you go to film school and things like that, is that the composer is always last.
Right.
You know,
last.
In general.
Right.
I mean, you always come to the composer last, and you don't even think about music until the very end.
Sure. Or if you do, the music is still written last.
Exactly.
It doesn't really help you, even
if
you,
But it's always good to hear about stories where, you know, the creative team is always talking to the composer or having a collaboration with them, because it is, by far, I mean, obviously the image is the most important, but in the story, that in the script and whatnot, but, you know, the music plays such an important role in that experience.
Sure. And the reason I don't have this cue on, like, YouTube or something, just with a visual, because it's so tightly cued.
Times, you mean?
It's everything. It's like every, it's a very vicious killing scene where with this thing.
Oh, great.
And I just didn't, you know, I kind of like said, if I post it, it's probably going to be taken down.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, it's very bloody. It's very, very, very evil.
So it's a killing scene set to this Baroque Vivaldi.
That was the idea. It's a little bit like, you know, it's a little Tarantino type, where it's like the visual is mostly in slow motion.
Huh.
No sound effects at all.
So it's kind of like, it's almost like counterscoring a little bit. I mean, because usually if you see a bloody scene, people think.
Right, exactly. Like, that's where the humor,
you know, Bernard Herrmann or something.
Exactly, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So the music is kind of what gives this part of the humorous twist to it.
So can you find this movie on Netflix, or can you rent it?
Yeah, and you can buy it on Amazon.
At some point. So you guys watching, you should check this movie out, because the score, and actually check it out on Spotify, the score is outstanding. I'm going to play about 30 seconds from the opening credits to give you an idea of another cue, which I think is equally as good. That took me by surprise. Here we go. So this is one thing I do want to ask, is that the jazz elements to your music, you have it in your most recent work as well. I mean, you have it kind of in The Man Collected Food, but you also have it in Trouble with Bliss. Is jazz a big part of your influence as a composer?
It isn't. I think it's part of, you know, it gives some lightness to the music. And the Trouble with Bliss is a band type sound. It's not an orchestral score. It was maybe 12 or 15 musicians. And so, you know, when you have a bass guitar and acoustic and electric guitar and drums playing, and if you're looking for something light, it sometimes naturally goes to kind of like slightly jazzy chords.
Okay.
It's more folk music, I think, if anything, than jazz.
Okay. Folk music is more of a...
And it's ethnic. It's the score is Greek inspired.
Okay. And talking about The Trouble with Bliss, like, what was the genesis of the project? Were you brought on, like, did the director know that they wanted you, or
did
you?
Yeah, I worked with Michael Knowles, the director, before.
Okay.
We both moved from New York about the same time to L.A. And we did some of his prior form shorts that he did, and one day I got a call from him, and you know, we met in town, and he said, "Hey, I'm putting together this feature, and it has amazing, great cast."
Did he have any ideas as to what the sounds that he wanted?
That wasn't not at that point, but that was an idea that he had. He said, He was looking. It's kind of a romantic comedy,
right? And it's about a guy who's kind of like, he's living with his dad,
right?
And his he's kind of like a loser a little bit,
kind of, yeah.
Can't get a job, and but he has like a board on his wall that he reads all these books and has aspirations of going to different places in the world. Right,
right.
But never
he
does
He has big
them.
Dreams, but never really never them. Did anything
okay.
with them. And, and I guess through the hour and a half of the film, his life is kind of propelled through crazy things that happen. He has this affair with
this young girl.
This young girl who ends up discovering
18, right?
that she has she's the daughter of someone he went to high school with.
Right.
And and a neighbor who hits who has this thing with him and Lucy Liu
and it has Michael C. Hall. If you haven't seen the movie, it has Michael C. Hall. And you can get this on iTunes as well. So you should rent it. I wasn't able to watch it over the weekend, but
that's true. And I think it's on cable. You can get it on
I think it's on
VOD,
demand as well.
Yeah.
And it did really well. I was reading here that it won Best Picture at the San Diego Film Festival.
Right.
Which opened some big
festivals. Yeah.
And has Peter Fonda, Lucy Liu, which is like big.
Yeah, a lot of great people.
Big
Brad Hanke and Sarah Sheahy and.
Yeah.
And
that's
great,
a big deal.
Great people.
It seems on the outside, and I'll show the trailer in a second,
sure.
So people can kind of get an idea about the story. But it seems like a drama based in New York City,
mm-hmm.
and you listen to the score,
right.
and it's heavily Greek,
right.
with these famous Greek artists
right.
associated with it, and like you said, more of an ensemble, not full orchestra, not like
right.
a 60-piece orchestra.
Right.
It has very very cool instrumentation. So what was the creative direction for that?
So once Michael came and said, let's think of how to make something interesting, and he came up with this idea. There's a backstory. Michael C. Hall's mother is Greek, and she died when he was a teenager.
Okay.
And one of the places that he dreams of going to is Greece,
because of the heritage in the story, in the film.
Of course, it's a small backstory.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't play a major part in the film. But
that's interesting, though, because it seems like this is the first time I've ever heard of a score playing a very important role in the backstory of a character.
Right.
That may or may not have a big piece in the
sure.
movie. Usually
sure.
you have...
It was a bold...
It's pretty cool.
Bold move, yeah. It was and I said, sure, let's try it. I knew it would be easy because, you have to justify it. You have to have it work with a film. And
right.
it takes place in New York City. It was less difficult than I thought in some places, in some of the cues, because it's a comedy. Once you have a comedic,
there's a little kind
there's
of
a little thing
you can punch
exactly,
on.
Exactly, and then something about the Greek sound,
It does have a comedic element
yeah,
to it.
Yeah, it can have
festive.
Some lightness to it that can be a lot of fun.
That's interesting.
But it was definitely, some of the cues were more challenging to do. Knowing that I had to always keep to that Greek sound.
So, talk a little bit about. I mean, you've worked with these. You worked with these very famous Greek artists.
Right. Some of them are just wonderful players here in town.
So, talk a little bit about them. There's Sophia.
Those are singers. The songs that we added for the soundtrack.
Okay.
When Sony, I came to Michael, the director, and I said, I think we have a really interesting score. It came out just, we had a wonderful Elliot Hunt, producer I work with,
mm-hmm.
Did a fabulous, just beautiful, beautiful production and mix job. Players were just fantastic.
So did you use local players here in LA? Or?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. But there's a big Greek community and a lot of great, great Greek players that are in town. Some of them legendary.
Wow.
Nick Dakis, who's one mm-hmm. of the bouzouki players on he's like a legend from the 50s and 60s.
Really?
He's an older guy now, yeah. And he still lives here in LA. And I found some others. I had to do some research and find really interesting people to work with. A clarinetist on it was just unbelievable. He's Ruben. He's just a real treasure.
And these people, these artists, they play specifically Greek music.
And the ethnic, yeah,
most of the
yeah,
time.
That from music from that area of the world mostly. And So when we finished the film was done, it was already in festivals, we knew it would be coming out in theaters. And I came to the, you know, we went through the materials we had because we wanted to put out a soundtrack. Mm-hmm. And I said, I think that if we, some of these cues, the director wanted some cues that would be almost like background music for, there's a recurring bar in the neighborhood where a lot of the stuff, a lot of the dialogue, a lot of the
happens.
Crazy stories happen. And Michael, the director, wanted to have Greek music. It's almost like this kind of ethnic bar where there's either people playing or jukebox playing or something like that, that kind of music. And he wanted us to create that music. He didn't want to just license or use something from a CD. Mm-hmm. I said, okay. So we had those longer, almost 3.5 minute tracks that were... There were already almost like song structure.
Right.
They just didn't have songs, lyrics. They didn't have any singing on them.
Huh.
And I said to him, you know, I think it'd be really interesting to try to connect with some people in Greece and record songs. Find a lyricist that can write Greek lyrics to it.
Yeah.
And have that as a bonus thing for the soundtrack.
That's cool. And so the soundtrack has, I think...
Four extra songs,
and these songs are these 3-minute kind of pieces that had already been
right. They have the instrumentals are the tracks that are in the film. The songs were just bonus things that
That's
we did
really
for
cool.
the soundtrack.
That's really cool. So, how did you find these artists in Greece? Did you kind of know them already?
Or? I didn't. It was just because we had all these really connected, you know, tight people
that
with the Greek community.
Right.
You know, just one thing led to another, and Nick's wife. Leah had a connection in some radio station, and they knew someone who knew other people, and we started looking, and we found this incredible lyricist, Maria Papadaki, who wrote, who I connected to, and she had enough, you know, they all were very, you know, the English was pretty easy for them. They didn't have a problem communicating and Skyping and
right,
you know, emailing
stuff.
And texting and all that stuff. The world is so small these days. It was really easy to do. And she just, you know, everybody heard about the project and was so excited to do it. So she immediately started writing, and I gave her some ideas of, you know, for some of the songs. I said, you know, I think based on the style of the music, you know, let's do something that's a little bit like, you know, ships on, you know, something very Greek or you know, something, one of the more of a love song. And,
right.
And,
okay,
yeah,
well.
And she just did a beautiful job. And then we started, I started looking for and getting referrals to... Through their business managers,
from
through
other
their
people.
Lawyers, to the singers,
yeah.
They fell into place.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah,
that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
I think we'll play a very quick clip from this score, so the audience could get an idea as to what it sounds like. And again, this is The Trouble with Bliss, and this cue is called the Irish Bouzouki.
Mm-hmm.
And let's check it out. So this is a very fun and eclectic score, and I'll play some different cues that I think contrast this first cue.
Sure.
But talk a little bit about how does one go about writing music? I mean, do you, like, that has, you know, kind of like a very traditional sound in terms of multiple instruments, lots of different themes. It's not like, you know, you have sheet music and you're writing for violins.
Right.
Do you kind of write a theme and put them in a room and say, okay, go for it, or do you have every note written out?
Some of these were more written out. There are a few cues that, you know, once you have string players, for example, and we did have a string quartet, we had some of the stuff is notated. It has to be notated. Mm-hmm. It's not improvised. Some of the cues were more, they were still notated, but they were more of type of like a chart, like a song chart, where you have chords, a bass line, a melody line, and the musicians kind of riff off that.
I see.
That's just, you know, just like you would naturally have a song recorded.
Okay, very cool.
So the bass player generally keeps pretty close to the bass line and the chords, and the guitarist sees the chords, but, you know, and we divided it. Yeah, and we divided the, you know, if the melody moves between the accordion and the violin and the other, you know, whatever instruments, the melodica, whatever was playing.
Do you compose on paper, or do you play on piano and write ideas?
It depends. Yeah, I do. I try to do as much as I can on paper.
Really?
Some things just don't necessitate that. You know, if you're writing an electronic score,
of course.
It's not necessary. It's not going to be helpful. And you know, everything is always so much against the clock. You're racing always.
How long did you have to compose this project?
Actual writing, I think, was maybe a month or two, probably 2 months we had to do.
Wow.
Yeah, we recorded in a few.
That's a lot of music. I mean,
there's a lot of music, and we recorded in a few locations. It was kind of, sometimes, you know, recording an orchestra can be a little, the actual recording can be a little easier because, okay, we have 3 days of sessions, and everything is done beforehand, and we come, and everything is already printed out.
Right.
And it's practically just having everyone there and tracking it. In this case, we recorded some of the band in Chicago.
Huh.
And then we recorded some of the overdubs and a lot of the soloists in my studio. And then we recorded the strings in a different studio.
Wow.
And so, yeah.
It was kind of more
a little more complex than a regular score that you just have, you know, and where all the cues are kind of like the same instrumentation.
Yeah.
And it was all mostly, there was a little bit of electronics, I mean, a little of synth music in it, added to the instruments in some of the cues, but generally it was live band type music, you know, 12, 10, 15, 8 instruments.
That's pretty cool.
And so, yeah.
How many sessions did you have in total, like how many, would it have been like 4 days or combined?
Actual recording?
Yeah.
Well, it's very hard to say.
It's hard because it was all over.
It was spread out throughout those 2 months, and you know, we and some of the things were very quick, and some of the things were so many versions until we really reached exactly what we wanted.
Were you composing during the actual process of shooting?
No.
Or this was,
I guess I was, I started sketching because Michael, I had a lot of time.
Beforehand,
yeah,
he talked to you before, right?
Yeah, Michael talked to me initially about the project. Mm-hmm. It was a year before. So we did some, once he came to me with the idea of the Greek inspired soundtrack, we wanted, then we had time to do a little bit of research.
Cool.
And see, okay, you know, Greek music is a very wide spectrum.
Yeah.
I mean, they have a lot of influences from, you know, the more Middle Eastern sound that comes from Turkey, and the more European sound that comes from Italy, and mm-hmm. the more actual Greek, real Greek sound that comes from. So there's a lot. So we listened to some stuff, and I brought some CDs, and just kind of like, Michael tempt a few of the things just to get a kind of like a feel of what it's going to do to the visuals.
And what was your? I mean, did he hear the Greek music and the visuals, and was he like, that's it?
Oh, he
like,
was very happy. He was totally into that thing. Yeah,
that's cool.
Absolutely,
that's really cool. And I'm still amazed that honestly, I'm amazed that the entire score. Like usually, you have like, you know, kind of an orchestral score, and then a few like different tunes. But if they have a whole score that's just the backstory of a character, it's very cool.
Yeah, yeah.
You don't ever see that.
And he was right. I mean, it's definitely something different. He wanted something
totally
something
different.
Unique. Yeah, and we definitely got that. Yeah.
Well, let's show the audience the trailer. And again, everybody, you can find this movie on iTunes and I think Amazon as well, and video on demand,
yeah,
of course.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, let's check it out so you can get an idea of what this movie is all about. And I think it actually features some of your score as well.
Sure.
What are the pins for?
They're all places I've gone.
Spain. Why Spain?
Homage to Catalonia. George Orwell.
Here?
Prince Edward Island. Anne of Green Gables.
Been to all those places?
No.
Another girlfriend. One of probably 3 zillion.
3 zillion's on the high end.
Yours?
Yes, me, Daddy.
When I was 35, I had a son, a job, an apartment of my own. See what I'm saying?
Not really.
Trouble getting it in?
What?
What happens a lot. Sometimes it just doesn't want to go in.
Excuse me?
Ever felt that you're waiting?
Waiting on what?
Something. Anything.
What's wrong with you?
I like you a lot. Oh, by the way, my mom is just thrilled that you're taking me to prom.
End it before it gets messy.
We should end the relationship before the emotions get tangled.
Your emotions are getting tangled?
This is the guy.
Georgie, we've talked about this.
Keeping 100% true to a tale isn't what's important. What's important is the story.
Hello, Daddy.
You remember my good friend Morris?
I might need a reminder. Oh, right, I remember. The two of you were best friends in high school. You did everything together, everything.
That's okay. It took me a few minutes to digest it all, too.
Whoa! It's me, Daddy.
What happened to you?
I made a choice.
So a little technical difficulties there. We couldn't make it full screen. But yeah, check it out. It's thetroublewithbliss.com. It's a cool website. It actually has a lot of videos on it and some cool information about the movie. But yeah, it seems like a very funny comedy, but a serious undertone in that this guy, you know, needs to make a choice about his life.
Right.
And one of the clips that I think was very interesting was when he tears this
map off
the wall. So can you tell us a little bit about this cue? I think it features an instrument. Let's play a little quick clip of it so that we can hear it real fast, and then we'll talk about it. What is that?
It's a clarinet.
Really?
Yeah.
I never would have thought that was a clarinet.
Yeah, it's just the technique. It's like an ethnic type of playing.
How interesting.
Yeah.
I mean, because I thought it was there's an instrument that sounds very
But, you know, a classical clarinetist cannot, probably, he can, but it would
so
be
are
as
they
natural.
Doing, is it with the pressure? Or
it's,
with
it's
the,
just a technique. It's
that's crazy. Yeah. Well, it's gorgeous. It's very, I mean, it's like I was hearing it, and I was like, "There seems to be so many different ways of note, like so many notes, like you know the triplets and the fast notes."
Right, it's very fast.
Is that like, does the player actually come up with these little tweaks, or do you kind of have as a composer? Do you
have
control over that?
I wanted to have control, especially when you bring someone to a session and you don't have unlimited time. It's just, you know, if we were producing an album, you could bring a person in and experiment and try things
and record and edit,
you know, and have it back and forth. We don't have that luxury when you're producing a film score. It has to be fast, efficient. I mean, you know, sometimes you do, but in this case, we didn't really.
That's amazing, as I think that most people don't. I just hear that and I'm like, wow, that sounds, I mean, it's a solo,
right?
But it sounds incredibly complex.
Right.
And I don't think people understand
right.
that those are actually notes that,
right.
that, you know, somebody thought about
right.
for that scene.
Right. So what I did was, I kind of mocked it up for him. I faked it with a sampler.
Okay.
With a, yeah, digital, you know,
right.
mock-up of it.
So he could hear
electronic computer.
He could hear it first.
Yeah. So when he came, we kind of had the timing laid out, the changes, because there are type of this kind of the drone on the bottom and there's harmonic changes moving. And I had that line, that clarinet line, kind of mocked up, playing very similar type of line. That didn't have to be exactly identical, but it was very, very close.
Yeah.
And we kind of did a few takes of each of these areas and just got very close to what we were looking for.
It's gorgeous. I mean, it's a beautiful theme. And I think it's interesting because we'll show this clip in a sec from the actual film.
Right.
But we've talked about this on the show a little bit about how there's different types of composing. I mean, you hear, for example, like Psycho, you know, and you see the guy with a knife and you hear the like, you know, that's like quintessential scoring for a horror sequence
right.
and you're really scared because of the music.
Right.
Whereas this, it's interesting because, you know, now that I know that it's backstory for a character, the music itself, you don't really see something that's Greek when you watch the film.
Right.
Like, you're watching this guy tear down a map from his wall,
right.
and in the background, you're experiencing this Greek music,
right.
and I think it adds a very interesting aesthetic
right.
to what I'm watching. It
right.
gives me a different emotional response than if I were to hear, like, you know, a guitar playing
right.
or something that would be, like, indie or something like
right,
that.
Right, 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 right.
Yeah,
and I think we have this when you see a map, you see so many countries, you know, there is that thing of
right,
so many
countries
on the map. Introducing something that is ethnic, it's almost like doesn't necessarily need to be specific, like I can spot, oh, clearly it's Greek.
Right.
You know, maybe it's Romanian, maybe it's Balkan, maybe it's
it makes me feel like
Yugoslavian, you know, whatever it is.
It makes me feel like I'm getting into his head. Like, I
yeah.
feel like the music's really in, you right. know, at least in this scene, it's like, it could be thought of as his dreams or his wants or, you know, where he sees himself.
Right.
But let's take a look and have the audience come to their own conclusions. Let's check it out.
Sure.
Very, very cool scene. Again, like, did you see this scene and know that you wanted to have a clarinet? Like, did you hear the theme when you saw it, or did you play around with the clarinet a little bit?
We played with some stuff, and Michael had, you know, that was one of the things that he temped with some of these things that we did. You know, we found some of the tracks, we did some research, and we found it's almost like a style. One of many that and he thought it'd be really cool because it's one of the more dramatic scenes.
I noticed that you used
film.
There's only maybe like three or four cues in this entire score that have this instrument,
the clarinet, yeah,
as a solo,
right?
Is that Is there a reason why you used the clarinet as a solo? Like, was this kind of like his instrument in a way? Like, did you do that on purpose? I guess is my.
It was purposeful. I think it just had a sort of yearning, just something about the sound that playing that ethnic technique, that kind of sound
There's an instrument that sounds very similar, and the name is escaping me.
Duduk,
right. Is that similar?
And he plays that too. Ruben plays that, the duduk has more of a kind of a whining, it's a little thinner and more nasal sound to it. And it took us a little bit too much to a Balkan wedding.
I see. Did you try it?
I didn't even need to try. I don't remember.
You knew.
He might have had it with him. I knew that it'd be too much. It wouldn't be, because we're still in New York. We're still in an apartment in New York City.
That's true.
And so we didn't want to go too ethnic.
The clarinet. It's just amazing. I've never heard a clarinet sound that way. I mean, I immediately thought of the Duke when I heard it's got to be that, but it doesn't sound exactly like it.
No, it wouldn't sound like that. No, okay. Absolutely. And that's amazing thing about doing a score that's like a chamber setting. It's like a few musicians and they're all, some of them are so brilliant. And so when you record an orchestra, the individual is a lot less.
Right.
It's like these are all soloists.
That's
and they're just, some of them are phenomenal. I mean, some of the bouzouki players, Grigor, one of the bouzouki players, it was just, I gave him stuff that was really hard to play.
Yeah.
Like, not only did he play it in an amazing way, he kept, some beautiful nuances and just the sound and the...
And that seems hard to do from, like, being a composer. You always expect perfection in your music, obviously, but... When an artist or a performer takes it in a direction that you're just like, wow, that was just like beyond.
that's being a musician with that. That's the pleasure of writing music. I don't. It's working with the players and having people enjoy it when they listen to it. That's maybe the greatest joy for me is working with the players.
Do you listen to a lot of your own music?
I don't.
No. You're...
If I do, it's because I'm trying to. Learn something from it, meaning if I do review something a lot or go through it, is because I either try to find the faults in it,
right?
Why it doesn't work, or what did I do that I could do better, or because I'm just trying to understand, what sometimes it's very interesting to just review and see why something worked or why something didn't work.
Do you ever go back and revisit some of your older work and?
I try not to.
Try not to.
But sometimes, you just do. You know, something gets played, something gets performed, something gets... We're never happy with what, we're always like...
You're always critical. Yeah.
Of course.
You're like your worst critic always, right?
Of course.
So let me show the audience just a quick other cue, which is called Foiling the Plan. And I really enjoyed the percussion elements of this and the pacing of it. And it'll give you an idea, which I think was a good contrast to the map sequence that we just watched. Okay. So let's listen to this cue. Again, this score is on Spotify. I really recommend you check it out. This is called Foiling Plan. We'll play about 30 seconds of this. Let's hear it. It's beautiful. I mean, it's beautiful music.
Thank you.
And it must have been so amazing to hear them play that.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So it's just the musicians. And you know, the instrumentation is just so special. This one is a very funny scene where they're trying to take over this building with squatters, and they're coming in there, it's like a paintball fight.
Okay.
But it never ends up being a fight because, like, everybody, you know, it's just, it's very,
they
it's very,
out.
Very, it's very, very funny. But, you know, just using a mandolin, you know, some of the such fun sounding instruments to work with. It's so something very crisp and very, mm-hmm. you know, bouzouki is just. Yeah,
so, I mean, it's a great standalone piece. You know, that's the thing that about the entire album is that, you know, you can listen to it as an album.
Thank you.
And have it be, you know, a Greek music ensemble of that has influences of Western music in places, but for the most part is kind of its own unique thing.
Sure, and I think that's why Sony Classical was interested in taking it.
So let's show, because you have some great you sent some great clips of the film, and we have a bunch. I don't know if we're gonna be able to get to all of them, but we'll try. This first one is a breakup scene, and I guess this breakup scene is with Michael C. Hall and his 18-year-old girlfriend.
Right. Or not girlfriend.
Or not, right, right. Not girlfriend. Right. And I assume he does not know that she's 18. He knows only after the fact, right?
Yeah, he gets he does kind of understand that
that she's not all there.
Maybe she's not even 18.
and that he doesn't know, obviously, that that she's the daughter of his friend.
At that point, he does already.
He does.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, let's check this out. And this features another cue, which I think is on the score called The Breakup, but it's from the film Trouble with Bliss. Let's check it out.
Just two fancy animals doing what they do. What doesn't kill you?
Only makes you stronger.
Nice knowing you, Professor.
So this features an instrument that I want to talk to you about, and I'm gonna play this cue for, and we can talk over it real quick. Let's see if I can play it here. So what is that, an accordion?
No, it's a melodica.
What is that? What is that? Is it? What does it look like?
I should have brought it with me. It's very small.
It's small. Okay.
It's a little plastic metal lump thing like this size, and it's.
Do you blow
has
into
keys
it?
Keys, and you blow into it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. I was like, that sounds like an accordion, but I'm sure I'm
way
off.
Yeah. It's almost like what you would get if you had a soprano accordion that only plays the right hand of the accordion without the buttons and the chords on the bottom.
And is this something that you had used?
Kind of.
Used before? Okay, you had played it before.
I played it. Yeah, I have it, and I used it in a few. I scored a TV show called Svetlana, a comedy show on HDNet with a colleague friend of mine, Dedi Tsurik, another composer. We do a lot of work together, and it was a Russian. But funky Russian type of thing going on.
I could see that.
And so again, we have this Eastern European thing with mandolins, and it was a really crazy funny score that we had to write for that for those seasons.
And is that released or is that
no, but I'm sure you can see the episodes
on HDNet.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, you know that
it's a I love that. I love the instrument. It's just there's something about it.
It's
a little bit between a right hand of the accordion and a harmonica.
Yeah, I was about to say that. It was like, it sounds, it's like this in-between element to it,
right,
that it doesn't sound airy like an accordion, but right, it doesn't sound like specific,
right,
tinny
it's not
like
thin
the harmonica.
As small as a harmonica, right.
So let's talk about another clip. Let's see. We have a bunch more. We actually have two more. This one's called Red Thread, and I'm gonna play the first, like, 15 to 30 seconds of this,
sure,
and let's talk about it before we see the clip. Here
sure
it is. Talk a little bit about this cue. Is it mandolin again?
Yes.
Okay.
So Greek music has an instrument. We use the mandolin to. There's almost like it's like a soprano. Called a baglama. It's almost like a soprano bouzouki.
Huh.
Okay. Smaller. Yeah, so we didn't have baglama, so we used that to get that kind of sound. We used a mandolin, and we.
So do they have similar
that high plucked sound?
Do they have similar sound? I mean, the mandolin.
Yeah, and that it's this kind of zorba,
yes,
sound that we got. So it's bass and but we probably if you played more of it later on, the whole band comes in. But that's what you heard. You heard the bouzoukis, the mandolins on top. There was a bass, regular electric bass on the bottom, and the guitars.
Cool. Well, let's check out this clip, and this features the cue called The Red Thread from Trouble with Bliss. Let's check out this clip.
The outfit and join the rodeo?
When in Rome.
What's that supposed to mean?
Montana, man. That's what they wear in Montana. That's what I'll be wearing when I herd.
Herd what?
Buffalo. Check this out. Patty gave it to me.
Was it a tapeworm?
It's the Red Thread. I'm in the cartel. I'm here. Come on. I'm gonna show you something. Come on.
Who lived in my building?
My Bliss.
So it's always cool to listen to the track by itself and then see it in the film.
Right.
Was this something that, like, this cue, in when I listened to it, it seems like there isn't a very definable theme. Like, I can't think about it and say, okay, I can sing the theme to that cue. But when you watch it in the film, it gives a chemistry to two guys.
Yeah.
Like,
right.
There, it seems
that
like it's
light,
kind of
funny,
defining their friendship a little bit.
Right.
So talk a little bit about these two guys. Like, I know that guy that we saw with the outfit or whatever, it's his good friend, right?
Yeah, he's a very good friend of his.
Is he actually in the cartel?
Yeah.
He
oh
is.
Yeah. He meets this girl. Her dad runs runs this chapter of some international cartel,
oh,
and it's like crazy stuff going on.
But their relationship is lighthearted, and it's a good. I mean, these guys are best friends.
Yeah, but they have this thing going on where. Yeah. But I don't want to say too much. Let people watch the film. But it was one of these things where we're through composed. You see, it's not. We're not hitting anything very tightly. It just was something that needed to be lightly underneath, like this light underscoring kind of flow. And the only thing that I hit was the end, right, when we see that thing.
And is that something that you hit? Like, is that something that you see and you're like, we've got to hit the end? Or is that something that the director
it was planned
sees?
And yeah, we just, it was partly scoring it that way, partly editing it that way.
Got it.
But, Yeah.
Well, one thing I do want to touch before we start the close of the show is your other work. You have, you do orchestra work, right? You do orchestra, like classical compositions.
Right.
So talk a little
concert
bit about
music.
Yeah, talk a little bit about that. And have you always done concert music?
I
tandem with film scoring, or
I started writing concert music before I even got to do film.
So that was like the first thing.
That's the first. Yeah, I classically trained. I studied, and that's what I started writing. And
So are you working on anything right now?
I just came back from a premiere of a piece that was commissioned for some festival in Europe. And it was very beautiful performance in a beautiful place. Amazing musicians, and so that's just finished that, so taking a breath. And there's
how long does it take you to compose like a classical piece of music?
Depends on the size of the piece, depends on the size of the instrumentation, you know, sometimes it's hard to even say. Sometimes orchestral music takes more time than chamber music, like a smaller setting,
right?
Because it's a little less detail oriented in some cases. This was 7 instruments. It was pretty detailed writing, so it took a few months.
Do you always do live performances of your work, or are you always composing classical music for yourself, and some of it you don't perform, or do you?
You
try
always
to perform?
Want it to be performed, so you always hope that either you write it for someone, for a group, for an orchestra, for an ensemble, for a player, or you get commissioned by someone
to write,
or a group or an orchestra to write it, because it's so time consuming.
It's like you kind of have to devote your life to that.
Yeah, does. It does take a lot of work, and it's a special kind of thing.
So do you have any live shows in the U.S. or here in L.A. or do you only do performances in Europe?
I don't have anything planned now, but I'm sure you know things. Yeah, when we do have them.
Walt Disney Concert Halls.
Exactly, right around the corner. Exactly.
That's the next venue, right?
Yeah.
Well, talk a little bit about the septet second movement, this waltz meditation that you did. So what's the backstory on this project?
I had a colleague, a really brilliant cellist that I got to be friendly with in Europe, and met him a few times, met him a year ago, and he mentioned that he's working, he's this is the 12th year that he was running this festival in a area, a beautiful area in the Italian side of Switzerland.
Sounds very nice.
Yeah, it's gorgeous, gorgeous place. And he said that they had programmed for that year, because they program all these, you know, concerts usually are programmed a year, even 2 years in advance. And he had, the program was the Beethoven septet opus 20, which has a very kind of unique instrumentation. It's a string quartet, but with bass. So it's a violin, viola, cello, and double bass.
Wow.
And then 3 winds, a horn, a clarinet, and a bassoon. Which is very few pieces are written for that instrumentation. I wasn't sure why until I started writing, and then I realized that there are idiots. Yeah, just it's not so easily balanced. There's not a lot in the high end of the spectrum, and I think that's why not a lot of pieces. Very few pieces were written for that instrumentation. Huh. But the Beethoven Opus 20 is like a masterpiece. It's considered
right.
You probably know it without even knowing that you know it. If you
I'm
heard
sure.
it, yeah.
It's Beethoven's just like every, you know, it's like one of those things. It's like people always say, I'm not good in classical music, and I was like, well, I probably could play you like 5 or 10 pieces that you probably will know without knowing.
Right,
who
right,
they are.
Exactly. So it's a very known Beethoven masterpiece, and he asked me, you know, the Beethoven is about, I don't know, maybe half an hour, and he said, would you be interested to be our composer in residence for that year? and compose something specific. They played another piece of mine in the first concert. This was the closing concert. It was a seven people, bigger concert. Mm-hmm. And he said, do you want to compose something like a septet, another septet of yours for the same concert with the same instrumentation?
Wow.
So I said, sure, I'd love to.
And what does composer in residence mean for the audience members?
It doesn't really mean anything. It means that you are for that festival or for that season or something like that. You are the composer who they commissioned, you're committed to write an original new piece for the festival. And so that's what we did. I started, I think, writing maybe in last September, October maybe, mm-hmm. started thinking, and it took a few months. I wasn't, of course, writing 8 hours a day every day because I had film projects to do and other stuff to do. I should have probably done it because I was like barely finished.
It's okay, I won't tell anybody.
Yeah. But they did a beautiful job.
It's really cool because I feel like, you know, it's weird with film scores because I actually have a background in orchestra. I played orchestra my entire life until my later years. And, you know, you play classical music and you get a feeling for the themes and the emotion that goes into these compositions, especially Beethoven. And a lot of classical music in general. But it's interesting to hear about, like, composers who kind of exist in both worlds. I mean, you have some composers that weren't classically trained. You know, they were in rock bands and now they're, like, big, you know, 80-piece orchestra composers.
Sure.
So it's kind of weird. But then there's a small group of composers in films, film scores especially, that, you know, are in the classical tradition.
Sure.
And it seems like that is mostly present in Europe. I mean, I see on Facebook and you know, news articles all the time about concerts for composers, you know, that are composing these pieces.
Right. Well, John Williams does a lot of classical.
That's true. He does
concert.
I guess
music.
He would be like kind of the quintessential American composer that actually does live concerts
that's
of his
true.
Stuff because of the
that's
Boston
true.
Pops and stuff up there in Boston. But it seems like, you know, there are a lot more opportunities for composers to compose classical work in
Europe
for just performance sake.
Right.
I mean, you hear of contemporary composers that just, you know, compose classical music.
Just classical music, right.
But not composers who are kind of existing in between both worlds of the film.
Right. I think I just talked to someone about this. I think, you know, it's a generational thing.
It's interesting.
It's a very interesting generation. We were born, you know, when I was growing up, it was just when synthesizers and samplers starting being really kind of common, prevalent. You can
sample and synth anything.
Yeah, and you can just, you know, if you were into music and you were into, you know, pop music and this and that, you know, having a synthesizer in the house was, you know, was kind of, and I think it was those 20 years were very, I think the generation before us were not, if you grew up with classical music, like, as a classically trained, you would probably stay focused on classical music. And today, I think it's very hard to focus on classical music. I mean, unless you really, like, you know, that's what you do, and you're a player, and you know, you start playing at six, and all but it's at least in film scoring. I think it was, you know, if you were doing film scoring 30 years ago, you'd be classically trained,
right.
And these days,
you
can be anything. Yeah, and I think when I was growing up, it was just exactly on that border, and so I was kind of did both. I was very into studio work and recording and synthesizers and samplers and that stuff. And at the same time, I was sitting and writing concert music and, you know, using a pencil and paper.
Yeah.
So it's just how I don't know how current, you know, young people now growing up.
It's tough now, I think, people growing up. I mean, well, I feel like as a composer, you have a lot more options to explore now that there's synths and a lot more technology give you the sounds that you want.
Sure.
But it also can be kind of overwhelming.
Yeah, it's very confusing.
Too, because
there's so much,
like,
to know.
What,
you know, there's too much to know as it is and harness all this, you know, and now being able to also take in all this technology and really master it and know.
Well, it's just one of those things that I really enjoyed about listening to your music, especially the trouble with Bliss, is that, you know, it just was nice listening to an album that felt real, you know, with real players and you know, just had a warm sound to it, where it's like, you know, you do listen to, like, the big synth scores, and they have their purpose.
Right.
But as a standalone album, it's always good to go back to the roots of where, in my opinion, film score kind of, like, stems from, which is the classical, you know, ideology and you know, composition. So speaking of that, let's show a quick clip from this septet second movement. It's the Waltz Meditation by you.
Thank you.
And where was this performed?
It was
in Sqitzerland.
Yeah, in Sqitzerland. Yep.
All right. Yep. So we'll put this up on YouTube later for you guys that are interested in seeing the full clip. Can check it out. But let's see a little preview here. Here we go. So speaking of work, like, how long did you have to rehearse with these?
I couldn't rehearse because I was flying in from here last minute. I just got for the I got in for like a little rehearsal before the concert and the concert.
So this was kind of like the first time you had
seen
it.
Right. They shared one of the first movements with me in like months before. They just taped it and sent it to me just to kind of get that was the first movement I wrote, was the third movement. And then basically, yeah, we just talked. We talked a lot over Skype and all of this and that, just over the notes, and I made some adjustments for them and some before, but
so do you think that as a composer will obviously continue the tradition of composing for films if they're
absolutely.
If it's something that you're passionate about and a story that you find interesting.
Sure, absolutely.
But will you always go back to the classical tradition?
It's very important. It's challenging. It's it's different. It's music for music. Mm-hmm. You know, we're writing for a film. We're there to serve the film, and the music, it's not that it takes the back.
It's not what you're seeing. I mean, you're not in the theater to listen to the music. Right.
Absolutely. Well, we you know, your main goal is to serve the film, and if the music needs to be background, then you need to be writing something that's background.
Right.
And so, and of course, writing, timing, the music, mm-hmm. to a scene. That's magic in itself. It's just special. It's something
true.
Special. It's your decision making, and how you structure a phrase or a, you know, mm-hmm. is dependent on the visual. And here you're writing something that's
it's more
totally music.
It's more it's you. A,
it's music. Well, no.
Would you consider it more of like you, an expressive?
I don't think so. I just think that it's just a different, it's a different approach to writing sometimes.
I see.
And it's just a different, it's just a different animal.
So what's on the next? What's on the agenda? Anything you can tell us about what you're doing next?
I actually, if I'm not mistaken, I have a feature coming up with a colleague with Daddy Tsur, the composer I mentioned before.
Very cool.
We started doing work for Chinese directors and producers.
Really?
It's a big market. And
how is that going? I mean, how is that going?
It's going really well. We did some very interesting films last year. We did two very interesting features. One was a big documentary about the Olympics, one of the Olympics that took place in China in 2010. And then we did a dramatic feature that just screened at the Newport Beach Film Festival a few weeks ago. Beautifully shot and very emotional about a woman with an autistic child comes to the city to look for her husband. Just beautiful, really beautiful film. And somehow our circles there are growing and opening, and we're meeting more and more people.
That's cool.
And so we're getting more work that's coming from there.
It's definitely an industry that's
huge. And it's also very interesting to work in foreign films.
Yeah,
It's a different dynamic. It's a different.
Would you say there's more importance on the music, or less so, or?
Yeah, sometimes it's just a different attitude towards the composer, towards the importance of the music, or. You know, stylistically, sometimes they approach things differently.
It's a new challenge. It's a new
right. With the Chinese, I think it's if you're a composer or a poet, I always say it's like I think that for them, you're like, you know, they're very special. Like, oh my God, you know, just.
Well, that's kind of fun too, right?
it's an interesting approach. You know, here where when you work with a director, you're very committed to the film, but there's also like almost we're all serving the film and. You do whatever is necessary.
Whatever it takes,
exactly. Yeah. And I think over there's still a little bit more focus about the individual that's actually doing the writing, which is just interesting.
That's an interesting way to approach a problem or to approach a creative project.
Right.
That
right.
People, at least in my experience, I've never had really unless I was in school or something like that, where you know it's about you and less about the project. There was more about like figuring out
right.
How to make
even when discussing, you know, when discussing the work or when approaching a cue or a problem you're having or something like that. It's just the attitude is just different. It's not better or worse. It's just something completely different.
Yes. I think you're right, and I think that's cool. So you've got.
So that's a thing.
Films in China.
I think we should be doing probably two additional films there this year. One of them hopefully in the summer, and who knows what else? I mean.
And writing.
Yeah,
more classical.
Yeah, I think I have another thing I want to complete, a quartet. There's a big string orchestra piece that I need to get performed. It's already done. It's already written.
So you just have to.
I had to. Yeah.
Find
that
players.
That was one that was written without a home, and so needs to find a home and get performed. So that's another project that I need to take care of.
So do you have do you collect any instruments in your studio? Do you have a bunch of instruments? Do you play an instrument,
I guess? Yeah, I play keyboards.
Keyboards,
yeah,
okay.
That's what I play. Okay. The place is filled with instruments.
That's so cool.
And Daddy is.
Do you record at your? You have a recording studio.
Do you
do a lot of the recordings there. That's cool.
Yeah, mostly solo stuff, and you know, I can't bring 20 people
to
record.
But if you need to record like a riff
something
like that, you can do that.
Absolutely.
Well, thank you so much for coming
on
this show.
Thank you.
It's been a great learning experience and a pleasure to feature this music.
Pleasure is mine.
I, you know, sincerely hope that you guys watching will check out his website. It'll all be up on our website and the post that comes later. And all of the YouTube clips and stuff that we show today are on Spotify or on YouTube, and we'll put that in the post as well. Find us on iTunes, find us on our site and on Twitter and Facebook. Subscribe to us. We have a really good show coming up over the next month or two. Thanks again for coming.
Thank you for having me.
All right. See you guys next week.